Read Psalm 25 responsively. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
My God, I put my trust in you. Let me not be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me.
Let none who look to you be put to shame. Rather, let those be put to shame who are treacherous.
Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths.
Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. In you have I trusted all the day long.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting.
Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your steadfast love and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord.
You are gracious and upright, O Lord. Therefore, you teach sinners in your way.
You lead the lowly in justice and teach the lowly your way.
All your paths, O Lord, are steadfast love and faithfulness to those who keep your covenant and your testimonies.
Our second reading is from 1 Thessalonians. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy that we feel before our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see your face to face and restore whatever is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you. And may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, just as we abound in love for you. And may he so strengthen your hearts in holiness that you may be blameless before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to stand as you're able for our gospel. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, "These will be the signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth, distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud, with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near." Then he told them a parable. "Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and worries of this life, and that day does not catch you unexpectedly like a trap, for it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man." the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Grace and peace to you from the one who was, who is, and who is to come, Jesus. Amen. Advent really messes with our sense of time. Not just in that greeting I shared with you from Jesus, the one who was and is to come. Heck, Jesus messes with time himself because of who he is. Advent, though, is a season that really does mess with time. The church looks back, the church looks ahead, and we do so at the very same time. I'm reminded of those images in cartoons of people who are confused and their heads literally spin. Do you remember those? This year, I have to tell you that messing with my sense of time seems much more normal than ever before. Because for the last year or more, COVID has really messed with my own sense of time. I wonder sometimes where time has gone. 2 years of pandemic has challenged my sense of time. I usually know what day it is, but not always. I usually know how time passes, but I have to confess, I'm at a loss to say how time has flown by in these 2 years. When we miss those ordinary, regular things that we've had to refrain from for some time during the pandemic, it messes with my sense of time. Our church calendar helps me, I have to confess. The weekly readings that I do preparing for church and our season has helped me keep track of time. But sometimes it doesn't, like Advent. We typically live in a very linear view of time. One event comes after another. And the church's lectionary and the calendar have cyclical patterns built into them, patterns of events that repeat themselves. So keeping that cycle in mind, the church year begins with Advent, setting in front of us readings about the end of history. Before we move in a couple weeks, the next three, to prepare us for the coming of the Christ child. In a couple of weeks, we will move to the Christ child and the dawn of a new age that he brings, an age in which sinners are made righteous through himself. The reading for this first Sunday in Advent, for today, addresses the end of history. Do you see how that messes with time? We're beginning Advent, and we're looking to the end of history. Luke wrote the words that we just heard for people who were really struggling with the question of time, or more accurately, timing. In particular, the question at hand was when the promised return of Jesus and the consummation of history would occur. The gospel writer Mark tied that event to the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. Luke, who wrote about two decades after Mark, distanced the promised end of history and the temple's destruction. In fact, Luke was downright vague about when Jesus will return. Luke refused to offer any hint of a timetable. Instead, though, Luke wrote, "Just as the budding fig leaves unmistakably herald the advent of summer, so also will the signs of the kingdom be plainly visible to all the Christian community." So the emphasis in Luke's teaching from Jesus shifts from when these things will happen to the manner in which the Christian community waits and anticipates. Christians, we hear, should be alert, should be ready for the coming of the end, Jesus said. They shouldn't be caught up in either the excessive pleasures or worries of the day, but rather remain watchful, be alert and ready. And at the same time, Christians should be confident and eager for the events that Jesus described, as they signal the approach of deliverance for the entire Christian community. Others, we read, may need to worry, but those are not in the church. Times will be most worrisome, Jesus said, for the world and for the powers of heaven. Interestingly, the word translated world in Luke's reading we read today isn't the more general world, the Greek word cosmos. That's what we read in John when we hear that God so loved the world, the cosmos world. Rather, this word for world is oikoumene, and it conveys a specific sense of the political and economic realm, the earthly world powers. Sometimes it was used to signify the Roman Empire. The coming of the Son of Man, the day that Jesus promises, will be threatening to the powers that be, but it will bring release from oppression and freedom and new life to the followers of Christ. So what ought the church make of it? And what ought we who hear this all these years later, yet another season of Advent in the beginning of the church year, make of these words? Well, I think if we look a few verses ahead of our small reading from today, we will get a hint. Luke tells us just a few verses preceding what we heard today that Jesus predicted a lot of what we will read about later in the book of Acts, in Luke's book of Acts. Jesus sort of laid out for the apostles, for his followers, the early church experience before using our readings today to promise that redemption will indeed take place. So let me share a few of those verses with you. Jesus said, just prior to what we heard a few moments ago, he said to his followers, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons. You'll be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify, he said. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you words and wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair on your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls. All of those things we read about in the book of Acts, in Luke's book of Acts. Whatever rumors Luke's community may have heard about the coming end, and no matter what rumors may yet come, the Christian community was to remain steadfast in its ministry, to do the work of being church, to share the good news. The church was to trust that Jesus will provide the necessary words and inspiration so that their work and their witness to Jesus through word and deed and prayer was carried out in any and in all situations. To our modern ears, apocalyptic passages like ours today can sound a bit foreign, strange, maybe even off-putting. Truth be told, we don't worry about the end of the world all that much. Truth be told, we don't worry about the end of the world even during a pandemic, even during a climate crisis. Most of us express little day-to-day concern about the end of the world, and even less probably about Jesus' second coming. In this respect, we might feel that we live a great distance from Luke's audience, from the people who heard Jesus say these words. Still, we are as intimately acquainted as they were with the challenge of waiting, waiting for an event that seems late in coming. We might be waiting for a national event or global scale event like the end of this COVID pandemic. I truly, truly wait for that, eagerly. We may be waiting for a solution to finally arrive that will alleviate our dependence on fossil fuels like coal and oil. Even an end to a decades-long war, once it happens, leaves us with additional worry as we await what may or may not take place in the aftermath. We might be waiting on a personal level, awaiting test results from a biopsy, or awaiting a phone call from an estranged family member or an estranged friend. We might be waiting for the safe return of a loved one who is traveling or on a tour of duty. Whatever the case, whatever we're waiting for, we know the challenge of waiting, the stress of waiting, and the anxiety that we feel as we wait. Luke and Jesus, in his words, offer us a perspective that, while it will not remove our waiting, it may affect how we live while we wait. We live, according to Luke and according to Jesus, between the two great poles of God's intervention in our world: the coming of Christ in the flesh and his triumph over death. And in this regard, we should not forget that these verses that we just heard serve as a hinge, a turning point, between Jesus' teaching and his passion and the coming of Christ in glory at the end times, his triumph over all the powers of earth and heaven. So this in-between time, though fraught with tension, uncertainty, anxiety, confusion, a time that can make our heads spin, a time that messes with time, this in-between time is nevertheless also characterized by hope. By hope as both the beginning and the end of the story of the church, and therefore our story too. This beginning and end that has been secured by Christ. We struggle, we wait, we work, we witness, we pray, we live, we die. All of this with hope. We do all of these things with hope because we know the end of the story. We have heard Jesus' promise that our redemption draws near. We'll sing together the first four verses of hymn number 257. Some that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to you, O Israel. O come, O wisdom from on high, embracing all things far and nigh. In strength and beauty come and stay. Teach us your will and guide our way. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to you, O Israel. O come, O Lord of might, as to your tribes on Sinai's height. In ancient times you gave the law, in cloud and majesty and awe. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to you, O Israel. O come, O branch of Jesse free, your own from Satan's tyranny. From depths of hell your people save, and give them victory o'er the grave. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to you,